We have seen in the previous video how to represent the material in terms of relative permittivity and relative permeability. The question now is, what will be the case if we have two different media, medium 1 and medium 2, and what will be the case of the electric and magnetic field at the interface between the two media? So, assuming that medium 1 has permittivity epsilon 1 and permeability mu 1, and medium 2 has permittivity epsilon 2 and permeability mu 2, and we have electric field and magnetic field E1 and H1 in medium 1, and E2 and H2 in medium 2. So, what is the relation between E1 and H1 and E2 and H2 at the interface between these two media? This is known as the boundary conditions. To solve this boundary condition, we are going to analyze the fields into tangential field components and normal field components. So, the normal field components has a severed boundary condition, and the tangential field components has another boundary condition. And it is assumed that at the interface between the two media, there is a surface current density, J surface, surface charge density, rho surface, and magnetic surface current density, M surface. We start with the normal field components to obtain the boundary condition for the normal fields. In this case, we are going to assume that this is the interface between medium 1 and medium 2. And we are going to start with Gauss law for the electric field. So the divergence of the electric flux density equals the volume charge density, or in integral form it can be represented as the integration over a closed surface d dot ds would equal the integration over the volume rho dv. In this case, we are going to assume that we have incremental volume in the form of a small cylinder. The height of this cylinder, h, is tending to be zero. So, in this case, the integration over the closed surface can be represented as the integration over the upper surface plus the integration over the lower surface plus the integration on the side surface. And because we are assuming that h tends to zero, so the side surface is assumed to be zero. So in this case, we are talking about the electric flux density in the direction of the surface, which is the normal component of the electric flux density. And for the case of the upper surface, the normal direction would be at the same direction for the normal at the interface. So, in this case, d dot ds, it would be d normal 2 multiplied by the surface area delta s. On the other hand, for the lower surface, the normal to the surface would be in the opposite direction to the normal. So, d dot ds in this case would be d normal 1 multiplied by the surface area delta s, but with negative sign, because the direction of the normal is opposite to the direction to the surface. So in this case, the integration over the closed surface can be represented as d normal 2 delta s minus d normal 1 delta s. On the other hand, the charge included inside this small or incremental volume is effectively the surface charge density rho surface multiplied by the surface area included inside this incremental volume. So the total charge in this case inside the volume is rho surface multiplied by delta s. So the integration of rho dv would be simply is surface charge density rho surface multiplied by delta s. Now, by eliminating delta s from these three elements, we can say that d normal 2 minus d normal 1 equals the surface charge density rho surface. So, the normal component of the electric flux density in medium 2 minus the normal component of the electric flux density in medium 1 equals the surface charge density at the interface between the two media. Or in vectorial form, we can represent it as n dot d2 minus d1. Effectively, the dot product between n and d2 is the normal component d normal 2. And n dot d1 is the normal component d1. So n dot d2 minus d1 equals the surface charge density process. In a similar way, we can prove the boundary condition for the magnetic flux density. In the case of magnetic flux density, the divergence of B equals zero, or in integral form, it can be represented as the integration over a closed surface B dot ds equals zero, and following up the same steps as in the case of electric flux density, we can say that delta s b normal 2 minus delta s b normal 1 in this case equals 0. So by eliminating delta s, we can say that b normal 2 equals b normal 1. Or in vectorial form, we can say that n dot b2 would equal n dot b1. The normal component of b2 equals the normal component of B1. So this is a boundary condition for the normal field component for the electric flux density, D normal 2 minus D normal 1 equals the surface charge density, and for the electric flux density, magnetic flux density, B normal 2 equals B normal 1. For the case of tangential electric, for the case of tangential field component, we are going to use the first Maxwell equation, which states that the rotation of the electric field equal minus j omega b minus m, which can be represented in integral form as the integration of the electric field over a closed loop, equals minus j omega, the integration of b dot ds, where s here is the surface area enclosed by this closed loop, minus the integration of m dot ds. Now, we are going to assume that we have a closed loop like C, such that the length parallel to the tangential interface equal delta L, and the length normal to the interface is H. And we are going to assume that H is tending to zero. So, in this case, E dot dl In medium 1, it would be E tangential 1 multiplied by delta L. And because they are in the same direction, so the root borrower would be multiplied by 1, cosine 0. Plus E2 multiplied by delta L. But here, E tangential 2 is antiparallel to the direction of the integration along the length. So, the angle between the direction of the integration and the direction of the E tangential 2 is 180 degrees. So, cosine 180 degrees is minus 1. So, it would be E2 tangential multiplied by delta L multiplied by minus 1. So, the integration over this closed loop, it can be simply represented as E tangential 1 multiplied by delta L minus E tangential 2 multiplied by delta L. Now, the remaining part is the first integration of the surface B to S, and second integration is M to S. Let us start with B to S. Here, the surface area is delta L multiplied by H. And because H is tending to 0, so the surface area in this case is nearly 0. So the integration of B dot ds in this case is nearly 0 or 0. But the integration of M dot ds is not 0. Why? Because effectively the surface magnetic current in this case is located at the interface. It has delta thickness. So even if H equals 0, the integration here will not be 0. So in this case, the integration of M dot ds, and because M is surface current density, it would be M delta H multiplied by the length delta L. So in this case, the integration M dot ds would be Ms multiplied by the length delta L. So in this case, we can say that E tangential 1 multiplied by delta L minus E tangential 2 multiplied by delta L would equal the magnetic surface current Ms multiplied by delta L multiplied by minus 1. By eliminating delta L, we can say that E tangential 1 minus E tangential 2 equals minus the surface magnetic current Ms. It should be noted here that the tangential field component is normal to the normal direction. And at the same time, the tangential field component are normal to the direction of the magnetic surface current. So effectively, E tangential and the surface magnetic current and the normal direction represent three perpendicular vectors to each other. This can be represented in vectorial form as electric field E2, total electric field E2, minus electric field E1, total electric field E1, cross the normal direction equal the magnetic surface current Ms. So in this case, this cross product, it means that the field which is normal to M and at the same time normal to Ms, E tangential 2 minus E tangential 1 equal the tangential magnetic surface current which is normal to the electric direction. For example, if the electric field in x direction and the normal direction in z direction. So this would be x cross z. So in this case, the E tangential 2 minus E tangential 1 would equal the magnetic field in y direction or in minus y direction. X cross z is minus y. Okay? So if the electric field in x and the normal in z, the magnetic electric current density would be in y direction. In a similar way, we can say that starting from curl H or the rotation of H equals J omega T plus J, we can do the same steps for the tangential magnetic field. So in this case, we can find out that H tangential 1 minus H tangential 2 would equal the surface current J surface, or in vectorial form, we can represent it as N, where N is the normal to the interface, cross H2 minus H1 would equal the surface current Gs. And once again, in this case, assuming that the normal is Z and the magnetic field say in x direction, so z cross x would be in negative y direction. Alright? X, y, z. Z cross x, it would be in positive y direction. Z cross x would be in positive y direction. Alright? Okay. So, as a special case, if we are talking about two dielectric interface, so we don't have surface current density, we don't have surface charge density. So, in this case, we can say that the boundary condition in the case of two dielectric media, the normal component of the electric flux density at medium 1 would equal the normal component of the electric flux in medium 2. And the normal component of the magnetic flux in medium 1 would equal the normal component of magnetic flux in medium 2. And the tangential component of the electric field in medium 1 would equal the tangential electric field in medium 2. And similarly, the tangential magnetic field in medium 1 would equal the tangential magnetic field in medium 2. All of this adds the interface between the two dielectric media. Assuming that we are talking about a dielectric medium with perfect electric conductor. In perfect electric conductor, the conductivity equals infinity. And if the conductivity equals infinity, it means that there is no electric field, there is no magnetic field inside the perfect electric conductor. So inside the perfect electric conductor, the electric field equals zero and the magnetic field equals zero. Okay? In this case, the normal electric flux density at the interface between the dielectric and the perfect conductor would equal to the surface charge density, which would be accumulated on the surface of the perfect electric conductor. And the normal magnetic flux density would equal zero, because there is no magnetic flux density inside the perfect electric conductor. So the normal flux density would be zero. And the tangential electric field would equal zero, because there is no electric field inside the perfect electric conductor. But the tangential magnetic field would equal to the surface current at the perfect electric conductor, because on the perfect electric conductor we can find surface current density. So it would be H tangential 1 minus H tangential 2, which is 0, equals the surface current at the interface with B G surface. So, as a perfect electric conductor, we can find out accumulated surface charge density. We can find out surface electric current density. And in this case, we can find normal electric field and electric flux density component, as well as we can find out tangential magnetic field component. As a hypothetical boundary condition is the magnetic, perfect magnetic boundary condition. Effectively, it is not found in real life, perfect magnetic conductor, but the boundary condition of perfect magnetic conductor is quite useful for solving many problems. So, in the perfect magnetic conductor, we are going to assume that we don't have electric or magnetic field inside the perfect magnetic conductor, and the tangential magnetic field would be zero, and there would be tangential magnetic current density. So, in this case, there is no surface charge density. So, the normal component of the electric flux density, it would be zero. And also, there is no magnetic charge. So, the normal magnetic flux density would be zero too. And the tangential electric field, it would equal to the surface magnetic current density. So, the perfect magnetic conductor allows surface magnetic current density, but doesn't allow magnetic charge. And it doesn't allow electric current density. So, the tangential magnetic field in this case, it would be zero. Finally, the radiation boundary condition. The radiation boundary condition is what will be the case of the electric and magnetic field at infinity. So, this boundary condition is known as the radiation boundary condition, and it is essentially for the energy conservation. It states that at infinite distance from the source, the field must either to be vanishing such that it would be zero, or propagating out in outward direction. So, either it would be zero, or it is going to a further distance away from this point. This is what called radiation boundary condition. Effectively, these boundary conditions are quite useful for solving electromagnetic problems in different cases. So, these are the basis for the solution of different microwave components. So, please keep it in your mind. Alright? Okay.